In this webcast, we're going to look at some more reactions of monosaccharides, beginning with oxidation and reduction processes. I'm not going to have you focus on the mechanism of these oxidation and reduction reactions, but rather what I would like you to be able to do is to just be able to identify whether there's been an oxidation or a reduction reaction taking place at a particular carbon atom. And the way that we can identify that is simply by looking at the number of carbon-hydrogen bonds to any particular carbon atom. In a reduction process, the number of carbon-hydrogen bonds is going to increase, and in an oxidation process, the number of carbon-hydrogen bonds is going to decrease. We saw that in the open chain form of glucopyranose, the carbonyl form, we could undergo a reduction process with the reagent sodium borohydride, where H- acted as the nucleophile to add into that carbonyl, and we converted the carbonyl derivative into the alcohol with an increase in the number of carbon-hydrogen bonds at C1. Here we're going to look at a couple of different oxidation processes, and there are multiple sites for oxidation, but we'll take a look at under mild conditions, which are bromine in water at 0°C, glucose can undergo an oxidation only at C1, and so there's a decrease in the number of hydrogens at C1 to make the carboxylic acid. And the carboxylic acid derivative of glucose is known as a gluconic acid, or in general, any aldose, it's called an aldonic acid. Well, it's possible under more forcing conditions, such as the conditions that are shown to the left, nitric acid, under conditions at 0°C for about 4 hours, can oxidize both the C1 as well as the C6. And so there'll be a loss of hydrogens at C6 also to make the carboxylic acid. And so we have the diacid. And for glucose, that's known as a glucuric acid. But for any aldose in general, that's known as an aldaric acid. Besides oxidation and reduction, a couple of other important transformations are ester formation. The reagent here that's important is acetic anhydride, AC2O. Its structure is shown over here. Basically, any of the hydroxyl groups on the sugar molecule can be hydroxylated, can be esterified, and the position at C1 included the anomeric hydroxyl group as well. So with acetic anhydride, we do a basic addition to a polarized pi bond of the anhydride, followed by beta elimination. The leaving group is the acetate group, that's this portion of the molecule shown here, to make the per-acetylated derivative of the carbohydrate, the monosaccharide. There's also the process of acetal exchange, and here we're going to take a look at the mechanism of this process. For all of the hydroxyl groups in the sugar molecule, it's that position at C1, that anomeric position, that is going to be special. So if we take glucopyranose and expose it to methanol HCl, we'll find that over time there'll be the formation of a new ether-type bond. It's known as a glycosidic bond. An ether at the anomeric position is called a glycoside or glycoside bond. And we want to understand how come all of these other hydroxyl positions are unchanged, whereas that position at C1 undergoes the reaction. So notice that almost all of the hydroxyl groups in glucose are unreacted except for that position at C1. Why is it that that hydroxyl group at C1 is the only one that is able to undergo this acetal exchange reaction? Well, the mechanism explains that, and it also takes advantage of the special stability of the oxocarbenium ion intermediate. So the anomeric position, that anomeric hydroxyl group, upon protonation generates a good leaving group that can form this stable oxocarbenium ion intermediate that we saw before when we looked at mutarotation. The stability of that is reflected in the resonance structure that's shown here. That resonance structure satisfies the octet rule on every carbon atom, and that's the oxocarbenium ion intermediate. The oxocarbenium ion intermediate is not able That is a structure that doesn't exist at C2, at C3, at C4, because there isn't the possibility of having the leaving group leave with the stability of a lone pair left behind to do this N to A pi type interaction. Well, it's pretty clear that what takes place from there is nucleophile addition to the polarized pi bond, a proton transfer, and we end up with the corresponding glycosidic bond. The anomer that is the most stable one is the alpha anomer. That's the axial position shown here. And there's an interesting resonance type interaction that involves the N to sigma star type interaction that's only possible for the alpha anomer, that's not possible for the beta anomer that is illustrated here. And the mechanism of isomerization is very similar to the mechanism of the mutar rotation. You might wonder, and this is just sort of to summarize what's in the mechanism and what I've already said, but why is it that the acetal hydroxyl group at the anomeric position is the only one that's replaced? And the reason is, if you were to protonate, and certainly this does happen, any of the other hydroxyl groups, say the hydroxyl group at C3, well, if it were to leave, it would end up generating a carbocation. And notice that there is no hydroxyl group on that position to help stabilize it. Unlike what we had with the oxocarbenium ion, where there was this important N to A type donation, this carbocation is too unstable, and it's a pathway, it's a reaction pathway that energetically is so much higher than the pathway that's shown up here that it's not a viable reaction pathway. So the only hydroxyl group which undergoes acetal exchange is the anomeric position.